Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Mrinmoy Pramanik. I teach Comparative Indian Language and Literature at the University of Calcutta. Today, we will discuss a module from Indian Aesthetics, and this module is actually introduction to Indian Aesthetics, introduction to this paper. So, in this paper, we have tried to focus on Indian aesthetics and poetics and literary thoughts across the periods. We have started with the Sanskrit poetics, then we talked about the Persian literary thoughts and Persian aesthetics, and we talked about the Bhakti Rasa, Bhakti aesthetics, and then we come to modern India, where we talked about the interpretation of ancient Sanskrit poetics and aesthetics, and we talked about the tribal folk aesthetics, we talked about nativism, Dalit aesthetics, and the aesthetics of modern stalwart, modern thinkers. So this is how we have organized this paper. And why this is important for English? Because English is not a single literature department now. English is practicing film studies, translation studies, comparative literature, Indian writing in English translation, not only English writing in English, Indian writing in English translation. So various kind of area studies English is doing. So when we are talking about English literature, or we are practicing English literature in Indian academics, we believe that we need to know a bit about Indian literary theories and Indian literary thoughts, aesthetics and poetics, which will help the English student to understand the concept of poetics and aesthetics in comparison, in the basis of comparative study. That in literature student, English literature student, they are studying aesthetics and poetics by Aristotle, Croce, and from there to the modern aesthetics, the Marxist aesthetics, the feminist aesthetics, Dalit aesthetics, so many things they are studying in their curriculum. So we believe that the Sanskrit aesthetics, the aesthetics and literary thought which emerged from the ancient Tamil, from medieval era, the Persian literature, from Persian literature, from Bhakti movement, from modern India, because literary thought, aesthetics and poetics do not have any language in particular. When English literature students are studying different kind of literary theories, they are experiencing, they are encountering different kind of literary theories, poetics or aesthetics, they are actually widening their knowledge, their views. When we are accommodating Indian literature in English translation, then why not the Indian poetics through English language? Because poetics, aesthetics and literary thoughts, English literature students are adopting in their curriculum from different areas of the world, from different linguistic zone of the world. So we propose such a paper on Indian aesthetics, what we feel that is necessary for the English literature student, for their bit, for having better understanding of Indian English literature itself, Indian Dalit literature, Indian tribal literature, and Indian literature in English translation, to have better understanding of the literary context of literature which is written in English in India and which is translated, whatever English Indian literature is translated into English. If a student would like to understand the background, the philosophy and epistemology of those literature, we believe that we have to understand the methodology and literary theories which have been emerged from India. And there is a brilliant contribution of Sanskrit theorist in Sanskrit literary theory. We can find different schools of thoughts on poetics. We can find in by the Sanskrit theorist. There is Rasa school, there is Dhani school, Vakrakti school, Riti school, Guna school, and different schools of thoughts we can find, and they have immensely worked on the language of poetry. They mainly worked on the Kavya and Natya. Mainly, the literature was understood by them as Kavya. So, Kavya was understood in very greater term to the Sanskrit literary theorist. And they talked about the meter, the genre. They talked about the responsibility of the poet, how to write the poetry or creative writing. They talked about the language issues. We can find the Bhartrihari and his Vakyapadiya and his Sphota theory. We can find the language theory of Kuntaka. We can find the Rajshekhara's Kabya Mimamsa as a book of a guidebook for the poets, that how to write poetry, how to write literature. Not only that, Rajshekhara has another importance in case of Indian historiography, Indian literary historiography, because his idea of Kavya Purusha helps us to form indigenous method of writing history. It can be used as a metaphor of literary historiography, and Sujit Mukherjee, Ganesh Devi worked on that. Sujit Mukherjee's concept of his book on literary historiography in India, he talked about Kavya Purusha. Ganesh Devi talked about Kavya Purusha in his work on Of Many Heroes, that in our history there is no single Nayaka, there are Aneka Nayaka, and that is what he calls it, Of Many Heroes. And that idea of Kavya Purusha was adapted as metaphor, as very helpful method to write Indian literary historiography. And there is the magnum opus of Bharata and Bharata's Natya Shastra, where in 10th chapter Bharata asks that rasa itika padartha, what is rasa? And rasa is relishment. Rasa proves the success of a poetry of Kavya and Natya. And in detailed manner, he talked about the dress, the makeup, the stage, the character, the plot division, and everything, whatever is related with a play and a production, everything in detail have been discussed in Bharata's Natya Shastra. And the rasa, the concept of rasa, first we find in Bharata's Natya Shastra. And then we find in Anandavardhana and in Abhinavagupta the theory of dhvani and dhvani rasa, that what is the main thing or soul of a poetry. Some theorist talks that it is riti, as Vamana talks that it is riti. Some theorist talks that it is alamkara, and some theorists talk it is rasa. Anandavardhana and Abhinavagupta, they talks about rasa and dhani and dhvani rasa as the soul of poetry, because alamkara and riti or vakya or shabda cannot make a poetry or a kavya successful if there is no rasa. And they talk about dhani or suggestion and rasa. And this is how we can find a brilliant and intellectual contribution of original Indian theory of literature, poetics of literature and language and creative writing and historiography from Indian literary theories, Sanskrit literary theories. So we believe that such Sanskrit literary theories should be discussed in a paper for the students of English literature to understand the creative writing and India's thought and contribution about Indian creative writing, Indian thoughts about the language and the poetry, structure of poetry, the essence of poetry, soul of poetry, and the Indian thought about drama structure and everything. Then we have the Tamil poetics, which is very ancient poetics, and the language theory and the grammar of ancient Tamil, which is Tolkappiyam. And Tolkappiyam has immense contribution in Indian thought of language, Indian thought of language and stylistics. that can be used as a method for the modern Indian languages to talks about the grammar, to talks about the composition and the different theories of language. So we think that Tolkappiyam is another important text which should be discussed, and there should not be any language reservation, that any student of literature who is practicing literature from India or who is practicing literature in South Asian context should know the Sanskrit poetics and the Tolkappiyam, the Tamil poetics. Next, let us focus on the Persian literary theories, literary theory, methodology of analyzing literature and theory of poetry actually emerged, flourished in medieval India, because once we find that there is no continuation of Sanskrit literary theory, or there is no continuation of Sanskrit theorists who are practicing theory in Sanskrit literature, and there is a gap in 300 or 400 years, and we get again a Persian literary theories. But if we talk about the ancient Persian literary theorists in India, like Amir Khusru, Al-Badawni, then we can find a continuation in the development of Indian literary theory. Because Anandavardhana, Abhinavagupta and other Sanskrit literary theorists, they are ending in 10th, 11th or 12th century, and from 12th, 13th century you can find Persian literary theories. The only language have been changed, and we have continuous Indian contribution to literary theory and thought. First it was Sanskrit, and then it comes about the Persian. So Amir Khusru is a rare talent in India, and he has multiple layered of artistic expression. He wrote poetry, he wrote history, he wrote criticism, and he has his own literary thought, one philosophical thought about literature. He was the first one who talks about, who captured the multilingual essence of Indian literature. He described the history of Indian literature, he talks about the Sanskrit Indian literature, and what is the reservation of the Sanskrit literary practitioners, what were the reservation of the Brahmins. He talks about the marginal literature, he talks about the marginal languages, he talks about the language of the farmers, agricultural people. He talks about the multilingual essence, multilingual nature of India, multilingual essence of plurilingualism of Indian literature. And in that sense, Amir Khusru is not only an important literary figure or theorist, but he is a symbol of plurilingualism. He focused on that. His Nu Sifir is very significant, very important text, what talks about the history of Indian civilization. He talks about the history of Indian languages. He talks about Hindustani language and many other language, Hindi language, many other language about it. He talks about Indian language, Indian literature, Indian civilization, Indian people, Indian festival, Indian culture. So in this sense, Nu Sifir is like the ancient medieval documentary of Indian literature. And this shows how to write, how to make a documentation, a documentary, how to write the history of literature and culture, because he proposes the historiography. And how to analyze literature, he also proposes all these things. And another important theorist of this time is Al-Badawni, and another important theorist in end of medieval India, in Mughal era, is Ghalib. Ghalib is not only a greatest poet, one of the greatest poet, but Ghalib is very famous to propose his own idea of beauty, own idea of aesthetics. Beside this, we have the wide Bhakti movement, and where from we get the Bhakti Rasa, the Krishna Bhakti, the Vishnu Bhakti, the Ram Bhakti, Bhakti Rasa we find. And we can observe the emergence of lower class people, we can observe the emergence of Indian Bhasha, the modern Indian languages, because till now, the literature was written either in Sanskrit or in Persian or in Prakrit or in Pali, but through this Bhakti movement we can find the emergence of literature in modern Indian languages through the stalwarts of the Bhakti. We can find the emergence of Bhakti in southern India. We can find its development, its contribution in literature by the Jain saint like Kannad Vachan. We can find it in Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh, Kerala, and we can find the in Rajasthan, Gujarat and Maharashtra, that how Jain saints developed the narrative poem, the poetry, the short poems, etc. And we can find Eknath, Nanded, we can find Tukaram in Maharashtra, who were writing the Avangs. So, emergence of local knowledge, emergence of Desh, Deshi Bhasha, Loko Bhasha, the folk culture through this Bhakti movement. And Bhakti movement has immense contribution in Indian aesthetics and Indian literary thoughts, that Bhakti is soul of poetry, Bhakti is soul of music, songs, and there is no difference between the devotee and the God. The devotee and God through their devotion are actually coming together, being together. So Bhakti proposes the Bhakti Rasa, which is a new rasa in Indian literature, and what observes the emergence of modern Indian languages and literature. Then we come to the modern Indian literary theory. After colonization or during colonization, we cannot find as much original contribution in Indian literary thought. But what we find here, that interpretation, new interpretation of Sanskrit and Persian, mainly Sanskrit literary thought, and there is Tagore, Anand Kumar Swami, Aurobindo, Bankim Chandra, Abanindranath Tagore, Nandalal Bosu, or Ramkinkar Bej, these people contributed in the aesthetics of art. And later we can find stalwart scholars in analyzing Indian, ancient Indian theory, that there is Bimal Krishna Matilal, there is A.K. Ramanujan, there is Suresh Joshi, B.S. Mardhekar, all these people, all these stalwarts. So we can find in one side the new interpretation of Sanskrit poetics, and another side we can find a new contextualization of Indian poetics. There is the aesthetic contribution of Tagore. Tagore is not only a great literary figure or great poet, but he is a theorist also. Through his Sahitya, Sahityar Pathe, Shantiniketan, in etc. essay collection, he talks about his aesthetic thoughts, his ideas about art, his idea about literature, his idea about modernism. So aesthetics of modernism also we can find from Tagore. He talks about the man's relation with the outer world, and how the world comes and mix being be together with man's heart, man's thinking, and literature or art is being produced. So Tagore has immense contribution in this new aesthetics of Indian literature, and Tagore has his own idea of beauty, what is expressed in his essay What is Art, which was delivered in US in 1917. And he got this idea of beauty from Upanishad, and that the idea of Satya, Shiva and Sundara, and he got the idea of beauty, and then this idea he practiced in his literature and in his philosophy. So we get Tagore, we get Anand Kumar Swami, who is a stalwart figure, who is a philosopher, who is a art historian, who is a theory of art in India. And there is Aravind, who took poetry as a part of politics, who took poetry as the essence of nationalism, and he talks about poetry which helps us in our helps us to imagine, which grows the nationalism, which become the part of politics. So we can find his different theory of poetics and aesthetics in his Future Poetry, that is very seminal text of Indian literary theory. We know about Bankim Chandra and his contribution in the idea of nationalism, and how nationalism makes a new kind of literature, changes the essence of literature. His song, which is written in Bengali and Sanskrit in mixed language, Vande Mataram, which is adapted as national song of India, and that was found in we can find it in Anand Math, and from that we can understand that nationalism as a idea of literature. And we have Suresh Joshi, B.S. Mardekar, Bimal Krishna Mathilal, all these contemporary and late modern writer, literary theorist. We have theorized all these theory of all these people. Joshi, Suresh Joshi, talks about interpretation. Bhartrihari and other Sanskrit theorists. There is V.S. Mardekar, for who has immense contribution in Marathi literary theory, and he is not limited only in Marathi, as Suresh Joshi is not limited only in Marathi, but they have their immense contribution, and those immense contribution in Indian aesthetics and literary theory, and those are adapted by any other Indian languages also, translated also into English. Now we have few emerging thought we have observed since last 3 decades. One among those is nativism, which is first theoretically formulated by Valchandra Nemade in Marathi in 1980s, perhaps in 1984, he wrote his first essay in Marathi on nativism. That nativism can be taken a theory which is truly anti-colonial, and what can propose the alternative of anti-colonial knowledge, epistemology, alternative of colonial knowledge, epistemology and practices, because nativism is held by Dalit and lower caste people, lower class people and the tribals in India, and that desh, that bhasha, that loka, that folk, indigeneity can be observed through nativism. So nativism is actually a call for write literature from Indian perspective, which will not be true Indian but bit hybrid, but it will adapt the Indian writing style. It will analyze literature from Indian literary thought, philosophical thought or critical thought. That is nativism's idea. And we can find it, what is very important or significant theoretical contribution of modern India or contemporary India. Then we have Dalit aesthetics, what is theoretically first formulated and proposed by Sharan Kumar Limbale in his Marathi original book Dalit Sahitya Che Sondarya Shastra, and it is also translated by stalwart Arun Kumar Mukherjee into English as Towards Aesthetic of Dalit Literature, what makes it understand or gives answer of so many popular questions related to Dalit literature, that what is Dalit literature and who can write Dalit literature, how Dalit literature can be analyzed, what is the purpose of Dalit literature, what is the objective of Dalit literature, what can be the theme of Dalit literature. All these questions have been discussed in Dalit aesthetics. There is tribal and folk aesthetics, because nowadays folk, so many folk and tribal traditions or orality are being recorded, documented in a writing form, and they have been translated from different Indian languages into English. So we need different folk epistemology, tribal epistemology or critical methodology to analyze those writing, to analyze that cultural critical discourse. So we need that folk and tribal aesthetics and literary theory, what actually have been emerging in contemporary India. Beside this, there are so many Indian leading Indian scholars who are practicing literature in outside India, but we can find Indian literary theory from their practices, like Ejaz Ahmed and his theory, and we can find Gayatri Chakraborty Spivak and his theorization on her theorization on her translation of Mahasweta Devi's Stanadayini or Breast Giver, and his concept of the theory what she formulated from the translation of Stanadayini, and that is important contribution of Indian contemporary Indian literary theory. And there is a book called Indian Literary Theory and Criticism by Ganesh Devi, where he accommodated the seminal text of Indian literary criticism and theory, and that is in English, what can be used as handbook of the for the student of literature to understand India's contribution from ancient period to contemporary period, India's contribution in Indian literary thought. Now let us conclude our discussion. So from this module we can understand that what is the significance of Indian literary theory written in Sanskrit, in Persian, in Bhasha, different Bhasha, in different languages, and why we should read it in English department, and why there is no boundary of language while we are trying to understand the literature. Because though we are studying in English literature department, but we are studying literature what are emerging from Indian land, from Indian socio-political cultural complexities, from Indian history, from Indian tradition. So to understand those literature, we have to adapt or we have to reconstruct Indian literary theory and new Indian aesthetics. For further detail, you can consult the e-text added here, and you can find all the references and bibliography there. Thank you.